Hey, we're heading out at Podcast Movement. We're talking with Jerod Mortis of Rainmaker FM, and we're talking about how to grow your podcast audience. So tell us a little bit about your podcast.
Which one? There's a lot of them. The Showrunner is one of them. I actually do two shows on Rainmaker FM, The Lead, which I co-host with Damian Farnworth, that's focused on content marketing. And then The Showrunner is the show about podcasting, which the basic tagline is your step-by-step guide for developing, launching, and running a remarkable show. And so that's The Showrunner, and I co-host that with Johnny Naster, who is also the host of Hack the Entrepreneur.
Yeah. So what advice would you give to somebody that's starting out in podcasting or doesn't, you know, maybe hasn't even started yet? What do you know now that you've done all these shows that you wish you would have known when you were getting started?
Oh, man. There's so much. I mean, this is going to sound really kind of simple, but just start. I mean, a lot of people really struggle getting behind the microphone for the first time for a lot of different reasons. And just earlier today at Pat Flynn's keynote, he played his very first podcast episode, which we all have that in our archives, and it stinks for all of us. And it was really bold of him to play it up there. And I think you just got to get past that. And I think understanding that once you get 100 episodes down the road, you're going to look back at your first one, and it's going to stink. Now, maybe it won't objectively stink, but to you, you'll think that it stinks. And that's totally okay. That's how it should be, because that means that you've started one, you've continued going on, and you've gotten better. So that would be number one, is just start and be okay with it not being up to your expectations. And then number two is start developing an audience from the beginning. And I really want to point out the distinction between listeners and an audience, because you can attract listeners, but building an audience means people who subscribe, people who get on your email list, people who take the next step to connect with you. And probably the biggest mistake that I made with my first few blogs and podcasts was always going for the traffic today instead of focusing on the connection that would last until tomorrow and past that. And so taking more time to really connect with people, to give people a chance to sign up for an email list, doing that kind of stuff, setting up that infrastructure in the beginning is really important, because you'll find some of your best listeners, even from the beginning, when your content's not that good, but they connect with you and they stay with you and they grow with you, and those end up being some of the most valuable audience members you ever have.
Sure. So how do you go, how do you take somebody from a podcast and dump them onto your website and get them onto your email list or get them back to your social channels or some way that you can, you know, connect with them and hear from them, as opposed to just driving to a site with an offer that you're not going to necessarily hear from them again?
That's a really good question. I think with audio, you have to be very clear with your calls to action. And I think you've got to really understand where you're trying to take people. So with The Showrunner, for example, we have a course that's attached to the podcast. But we also have an email list for people who listen to the podcast, who want a little bit more. And we tell them during the shows, go to showrunner.fm and get on our email list. And then it's very clear what the benefit is, because we have a content series called The Four Essential Elements of a Remarkable Podcast. So it's our basic curriculum. So whenever anybody finally, you know, hears their first episode of The Showrunner, then they can go get more of the background. And it's just, I think it's about being clear, number one, and kind of telling people where they should go next to get more value from you, and then actually offering value. So we give people on our email list something extra that the listeners to the podcast don't get, and that entices them to take that next step. And then we're able to connect more once we have them on the email list.
Yeah, absolutely. And speaking of connecting, how do you solicit feedback from your listeners to let you know that you're doing the right job or you're headed in the right direction with the content that you're giving them, both in your emails and in your podcast?
We ask them to email us and we respond to them. So I think one mistake people make that I've heard is that they, you know, they'll get emails from people and they don't necessarily respond to them. I mean, if we get comments, if we get emails, we really try and engage people and really ask them what's working and try and get specifics for areas that they really need help with that maybe we didn't explain very well, that we could do better. And so I think taking any opportunity that you can to engage with people, especially one-on-one, is huge. And part of that is letting people know that you're receptive to it. You know, we say, hey, email us. You know, we will respond to you. We want you to respond. And then when people get on the email list, ask them questions inside of the emails. It's a great way to see how engaged your list is. Because when you have an email list, obviously, then you ask, have a call to action in there. If no one's responding to it, maybe no one's reading, you know. But then if you show people that they take the time to email you, you'll actually email back and engage with them. You know, obviously, at a certain point, the numbers may be so great that you can't do that. that's a great problem to have. But I think part of getting there is putting in that time, especially at the beginning, to really connect with people. Because you're going to learn so much when you do that that's going to help inform how your content grows to get to that point where then you don't have time to respond.
Yeah, absolutely. And that is a great problem to have.
Yeah.
Something I'm sure everybody, you know, dreams of and works towards. So have you collaborated with other podcasters to help grow your audience, or, you know, have people on your show or go on their show?
Yeah, I think that's a great way, especially when you're starting out. I think interviewing people really helps you, because a lot of times those people will then share the interview, and then you can help kind of tap into their audience. And it's just a great way to learn and to share experiences. I mean, that's one thing, you know, with the Showrunner and having the community inside of the course with a bunch of like-minded people who are starting podcasts, have been running podcasts, that support is huge too, because it's hard. Like, it's hard to get behind the microphone, to produce good content, to do it on a regular basis, and we all go through it. It's the same thing with blogging. You know, there's those little dips where the enthusiasm drops or the audience reaction isn't quite what you want. And then kind of how do you get back into it? How do you get that next injection of adrenaline into the project? And I think working with other people is a great way to do that.
Absolutely. Now, do you produce lots of episodes? Do you have like a library of content that's yet to be released, so that way, you know, if you do have a dry period, you kind of have something that's ready to go?
I don't do that.
Yeah.
John Napster, who co-hosts with me on The Showrunner, he's a big proponent, especially before you launch, of having a huge library of episodes. And frankly, I think he's right. I've just never been very good at doing that. I'm a little bit more impatient, to where when I create, I want to get it out. And so, no, I do think it's a really smart thing to do. And actually, it's something that I want to kind of start to get more of that in the can, so there is something there. But I don't do that. Now, what I do try and do is really schedule. And I've done a lot with recording live shows and then turning them into podcasts. And the reason why is, if it's live and if it's scheduled, you have to show up. So that always gets me past any type of apathy, any type of fear. It's like, well, it's live and I have to show up, so I got to prepare for it. Let's do it. And that kind of helps drive me through that. And then I know I'm getting a piece of content out of that.
Right. Absolutely. So you're saying that John Napster gave you the advice that maybe, you know, gave you the idea that you should be building up more things, more library of the content. I'll just end with this one. What's the best piece of advice that you've ever received? It's a pretty open-ended question.
Boy, that's a great question. The best piece of advice that I've ever received. You know, there was a piece of advice earlier today at Podcast Movement, frankly, that I thought was brilliant, from Roman Mars, who hosts 99% Invisible. And he said that one of the ways that you succeed and one of the ways that you turn podcasting into a business is by serving an audience. And that is definitely true. You have to do that. But as he said, part of that is you also have to serve yourself. Because for a lot of projects, podcasts, blogs, anything, the only feedback, the only positive thing that you'll get out of it is your own pride in producing something good. So that's got to be an important part of it, is really taking pride in producing something good, independent of if anybody listens to it. You know, serving yourself as an audience first. And then a lot of times when you do that, you produce something great for your audience too. So you have to combine it with the humility of knowing the audience, caring about the audience, making it something that's important to them. But I think a big part of that is understanding that you're part of your own audience too. And if you're not connecting with your content, if you don't think it's good, if you're not really invested in it, you can't really ask your audience to be too. So kind of combining those two mentalities, I think, is what really creates kind of the perfect mentality for doing this well over the long term.
Absolutely. I feel like we've heard from two camps. We've heard from people that kind of use podcasting as an extension of their business. Mm-hmm. And then some people are just doing it as a passion project.
Yeah.
But I think that passion needs to be there no matter which way you go.
I agree. Well, because, I mean, podcasting is a medium of connection. Your voice is inside of people's heads. And so you can write copy that isn't necessarily passionate but gets the job done, but there's such a disconnect because it's just words on a page. You can't hide it. If you don't have passion, you can't hide it when your voice is out there. Like, it's literally, it's, you know, they're like, I don't know, it's biological, whatever the term is. Like, we pick up on other people's voices and whether they're passionate, and there's just little things that we can't recognize but that are happening. And with your voice, like, that just happens. So, and that's going to come out naturally. So having that connection with the content is so important. I just did a horrible job of explaining that, but hopefully I did it with passion and enthusiasm.
I got it, and I think it's really important. So thank you for talking with us.
No, for sure. This is great. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.